Hello students and welcome to MME 6134 Advanced Manufacturing class for the topic Surface Engineering. So in this chapter of Surface Engineering, we have selected the topic Surface Properties, and in the Surface Properties, there are four subtopics: Surface Structure, Surface Integrity, Texture and Roughness. So let's take a look at why do we need to study Surface Engineering first. So when we talk about surface engineering, it's all related to the surface structure and integrity. Surface engineering is important in the development of products because the surface of the product identifies its functionalization. So as an example, you can see on the left hand side, you've got a plant, and the name of the plant is Selvina molesta. And in many instances, this is a natural plant and nature has created super hydrophobic surfaces. This allows plants and insects to survive underwater for not even hours, not even days, but for weeks. So this kind of Selvina molesta is an extremely invasive fern that can survive underwater for weeks and continue to photosynthesize. It has a very complex structure surface, as you can see. The surface of this plant is quite complex. It has a water repellent surface. As you can see, you have got a water droplet, and this plant surface is repelling the water. The reason why is that it holds a protective airs of pocket in between its lobes. Okay, and then what happens is that those arrays of these whisk hairs, basically, they repel the water, and they are called trichomes. The tip of the whisk is basically chemically distinct and been hydrophilic, and this firmly pins the water layer to the surface with the air trapped in between. So this, the pinning effect, keeps the air layer and then keeps the water away, creating a negative pressure in the pockets. So due to this structure of the surface and individual ferns which are created, basically a property called hydrophilic property has been obtained. Now, with the help of advanced manufacturing technologies, we also can create such kind of structures and such kind of surfaces. And those kind of surface structures can be developed with the help of lasers and with the help of different manufacturing techniques. So now this is possible. As you can see, we have got a dropper which has dropped a droplet of water, and this water droplet cannot be wetted by this surface. So this is the description of the nature of surfaces, how we can learn from the nature and integrate those natural surfaces into our engineered surfaces to obtain different types of functions for different applications. So now we are going to look at the surface structure. What does the surface structure looks like? And so here is an example of basically a schematic illustration of a surface. Okay, and a surface is not just a single surface, it has got a lot of different layers and components. So upon close examination of this picture or a surface, you will find different important layers which are basically present in a surface or on a material. So number one is the bulk material. And bulk material is also called a metal or a substrate if it is not a metal. And it has a structure that depends on the composition and processing history of metal. So for instance, if this metal substrate, you have carried out casting, then perhaps you will see EQX grains, or you will find directional solidified dendrites structure. If it has been manufactured by a deformation method or forging method, then the grains and the grain structure might be different. So after metal substrate, we have got the work hardened layer. Work hardened layer basically corresponds to the fact that if you have carried out some machining or you have carried out some additional finishing operation, then the grains or the structure of the surface becomes plastically deformed due to the process that you have carried out. So this part is called plastically deformed or work hardened layer, and it depends on the extent of manufacturing that you have carried out. Then the third layer is an oxide layer. So different materials have different oxides. For instance, if your bulk metal is iron, then iron oxide might be present. If it is copper, then copper oxides are present. So when we talk about iron specifically, then it has got iron oxide, And then above iron oxide, there is another layer which is iron Fe3O4. Then there is another layer called Fe2O3. So iron has got different layers of oxides which are present within an oxide layer. Similarly, if you talk about aluminum material, then aluminium has got dense amorphous alumina Al2O3 oxide layer present. And then they have got their own specified thickness, which are formed based on the environment and humidity or environmental conditions. Then the third, if you talk about copper, then copper, when you do machining of a copper, you will find that it is very shiny and very bright. But after some time, within some hours, copper oxide CuO starts to form. And then the CuO is dull, so the layer becomes dull and it's not as shiny as it was when it was freshly machined. Then next we move on to stainless steel. So when we talk about stainless steel, then it is formed because we want to have a corrosion resistant material. So chromium oxide is formed in the stainless steel, and it acts as a protective barrier against corrosion and corrosion products. So after the oxide layer, we have got adsorbed layer. So under normal environmental condition, the surface oxide generally has adsorbed layer of gases or moisture. So that moisture and gases are also absorbed on the surface. And then above that, there could be any contaminants that are formed due to, let's say, metal debris or some kind of fabric which attaches to metal surface, or some grease or any kind of contaminant that could potentially be available on the toppest or the most toppest part of the surface. So these are the overall generalized parts, surfaces, work metal substrate, deformed surface layer. Then you've got oxide layer, adsorbed layer, and contaminants layer. So students, let's take a look at surface integrity. Surface integrity, as you can see from this picture, it is showing some features, as you can see some defects. So surface integrity basically refers to important aspects and consideration that happens in manufacturing operations, because the surface integrity basically it affects the properties such as fatigue, strength, corrosion, and service life of a material. So what does surface integrity includes? Surface integrity basically includes the topological, physical, chemical, mechanical, and metallurgical transformations and properties and characteristics that occur during the lifetime of a surface. So for instance, if you talk about defects and defect-based features, then we can name a lot of features that can occur during the surface lifetime of a material. For instance, if you have got a microphone, if you got a phone, smartphone, then you can find that over the period of time, you can find scratches that occur, sometimes dents occur. So those are the surface features that are prominent. So cracks, craters, heat affected zone, inclusions, laps, folds and seams, metallurgical transformations, pits, residual stresses, all happens due to either manufacturing process or due to service lifetime. So here you can see in the figure A on your right hand side, this is basically a friction stir welded portion of a material, and as you can see, significant plastic deformation occur, and you can see those plastic deformation causing material to flow in this direction as shown in the arrow. And another thing that you can see is that you can see some of the burrs are created in the form of very, very small chips or metal deformations. So you can see some plastic deformation, you can see some burrs, and furthermore, you can see that some of the part has become shiny and some of the part has become dull. So perhaps there might have been some metallurgical transformation as well. So if you want to see what the defects look like, then you can look at the figure below. Some of the defects commonly found in manufacturing are presented. So why is surface integrity important? So let's take an example and see what happens. You guys might have gone through root canal for your teeth. So what happens is that it's quite painful. You've got bacteria which is basically formed. So in order to remove this bacteria and remove the infected pulp which is present here, what happens is that they use some files, and these files are made of nickel titanium alloy. This is shape memory alloy, highly deformable, and it retains its shapes. So these are called files, and these files have got a drill. They have the shape of a drill bit, And once they put it inside, then they basically screw it inside and they remove the material and the pulp. So they remove the dead material by basically using it as a screws and drilling it manually. So what happens to these files? What happens to the surface of these files? Because the surface is what is important. All the material removes and gets out through the helical surface. So here, as you if you see in the figure on your right and left hand side, we've got scanning electron microscopy. Scanning electron microscopy gives us magnification to about 300x to 3000x to even 50,000 to 100,000x as well, so that you can see some nanoparticles as well. So here in this figure, we have got a magnification of 300x, and then we have got the file of endodontic nickel titanium alloy. Okay, it is an instrument, and after doing the operation on your teeth, what happens there? Remove the file and put it under a microscope to observe the surface features. And what they observed was that if you see on your right hand side, on your left hand side, you can see cutting edge deformation. So the edge of the tool has deformed. You can see the deformation present on all the edges. Furthermore, if you look closely on this file, okay, surface deformation on another type of file is seen. So the surface, it has deformed. And you can see the deformation marks or the deformation patterns means that the material has flowed towards those patterns. So this is what defines surface integrity, the features which occurs before manufacturing, during the lifetime, and at the cessation of its service. And it gives us a lot of information about the performance of the material and how it performed in our for our function, which in this case was to remove the plaque and dental germs and bacteria.